our church and the life of our community, but we are glad that you are here today. We are glad to celebrate Mother's Day, and we'll say more about that in a few minutes. We are glad to honor our graduates, our brand new high school graduates, and they will be at the 11 o'clock service. They're having breakfast together right now, but an outstanding group of young people, and you can read a little bit about them with the insert in the bulletin. As we're congratulating young people, you know that we had three of our youth were in the state track meet yesterday, representing Starkville in the 6A. We have three state championships, individuals. Charlie Henderson won the boys' pole vault in the 6A, and Kate Maddox, for one more time, won the 1600 and the 3200, 6A, moved up a classification this year, and so she is just a freshman and has won more state championships than I have fingers to count on, I think, already. We congratulate them and all of our young people who do so well in so many different things. It is a busy time in the church as we get ready for summer. I do need to make one change on the schedule. I said I was going to teach Bible study at 11 o'clock this Tuesday. I'm going to have to postpone that. I have an appointment that I have to be at that's going to conflict with that. So I will have Bible study Wednesday night, but not Tuesday morning this week. And I'll let that class know when we will be back together. But glad that you are here and look forward to going into this season together. Do want to remind you of the Senior Services Sunday Fund. This fund actually helps people who get into the Methodist senior centers, which are all over the state of Mississippi, and sometimes after they get there run into some sort of financial difficulty. And this is a means of supporting them, and that's what the Mother's Day Sunday Fund offering goes for. And you can use this envelope or take this with you, and if you need more information on that, but we support that every year. I want you to sign the attendance pass so we might have a record of you being here and sharing in this service with us today. And now, would you take your bulletin and let's stand as we turn to the call to worship. Today is a gift from God.
Today we honor all those who have loved us as mothers.
Tomorrow is a gift from God.
Today we honor those who spend their lives preparing for tomorrow.
May God bless us all. Most gracious Heavenly Father, you have blessed us in many ways, and you've blessed us through many people. Help us to take time in these days to show our appreciation to those who've raised us, to those who've taught us, to those who have shown us something of your love. We thank you for this day, for this chance to worship. We are here in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Our hymn of praise is number 139, Praise to the Lord the Almighty.
together through the Apostles' Creed. May we unite in this historic confession of our Christian faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Go to our Lord in prayer. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this day. Of all the things we have in common, one thing we all have in common is we've all had mothers, and we've all had people who have loved us as a mother. We thank you for the memories. We thank you for the love. We thank you for the lessons. We thank you for the sacrifices. We thank you for all the good things that went into are becoming the people that we have become. And we do take time this day to honor all of our mothers and all of those who have loved us and raised us over these years. We wish your blessing upon them. And for those who are still in the midst of the joy of small children and teenagers especially, grant them patience. Grant them understanding. Grant them the strength they need to continue in this important role. We thank you for people who step in when others fall aside. We thank you for people who go beyond what is required to help raise children. Because it does take a church. It does take a whole family. It's not just one person's or two persons' responsibility. But all these children, all these young people, are a shared responsibility of our community. As they came before us in baptism, we pledged to surround them with love. We pledged to teach them, to set an example. We thank you for the young people who are graduating today or celebrating their graduation today. We thank you for the gifts they have brought to this church in music, in faith, in service. And ask that you continue to be with them and bless them as they go off to new adventures and new places in your world. We have lots of friends who are hurting this day. We have friends who are sick. We have friends who have surgery awaiting. We have friends who are waiting to hear the results of the test. Be with them. Let them feel your strength. Let them know our love, but let them feel your power in whatever they are going through. We pray all these things in the name of your Son and our Savior, Jesus the Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now time for our children.
Great to see you all today. How are you? Good morning. I want to show you some pictures. Let's get fixed down here. Hey, come on up. Let's see if I can do this upside down. Hey, Adele, come out here. Would you? I'd love to have you sitting right here beside me, but I want you to be able to see some of these pictures. Can you tell what that's a picture of?
Hey, kids.
Good morning.
Hey, Sam. Yeah, so we got
Okay. Don't touch the screen, because if you touch the screen, who knows what it'll do, and I don't know if I can get it back. It's a touch screen, Henry, and there's no telling where it would go, and I probably couldn't get it back. Let's look. Can you tell? That's a little boy. And what he's so? But what is he? Did you know that? Can you see it, Caitlin?
A shepherd.
Let's see. There's an old man. Can everybody see? Can you sit back just a little bit? Can you see? Emma, can you see? Come up closer. Let's see if there's one more. There you go.
There's a shepherd.
There's a shepherd. Can you see, Will? Let's see one more. I like this picture. Going down a lane. What do you call a group of sheep that a shepherd takes care of? Do you know the word?
Flock.
That's right. A flock. Now, as you can see, well, birds are called flocks too. That's right. So flocks can be different groups, but in this idea, a flock of sheep. So these pictures, it's really neat, because these are not pictures from a long time ago. These are current pictures of shepherds who still take care of sheep. Now, it's a hard job being a shepherd, because the shepherds are out in the fields all the time with the sheep, out in the weather, whether it's cold or rainy or hot. They're out there taking care of the sheep. The shepherds give the sheep everything they need. The shepherds get the sheep to food. The shepherds get the sheep to water. If a sheep is injured or hurt in some way, the shepherd will take care of it. The shepherd knows the sheep. And sometimes, even though a shepherd gives the sheep everything they need, sometimes the sheep will still wander off. And the shepherd knows every one of his sheep. And the shepherd will go after them and bring them back. The shepherd protects the sheep from wild animals and from thieves. Now the sheep know the shepherd also. And they know his voice. And the shepherd, most shepherds have a special call, a special way that they call their sheep. And the sheep will respond and come to them. So shepherds take care of sheep, don't they? Even when the sheep may not want to be taken care of. Let me show you this. Some of the most famous, do you see my Bible? Oh, here it is. One of the most famous verses in the Bible is about a shepherd. And if you take your Bible, you get your Bible at home, and you take it and you open it to the middle of the Bible, maybe a little bit more toward the front, you'll find... I'm upside down. I'm not. You'll find the book of Psalms. And in the book of Psalms, this verse I'm talking about comes from the 23rd chapter of the book of Psalms. And it was written by David. Before he was a warrior and before he was a king, David was a shepherd. That's right. So Psalm 23 starts like this. You've probably heard it. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Now, I shall not want means I have everything I need. So it goes like this. The Lord is my shepherd. I have everything I need. Think back to how a shepherd gives a sheep or a flock of sheep everything they need. So when we can say, God, the Lord is our shepherd, he gives me everything I need. Today we've got two special occasions going on. It's Mother's Day. And on Mother's Day, we are especially grateful to our mothers, to our grandmothers, to aunts, and to other people who are like mothers to us. Mothers are kind of like shepherds, aren't they? Grandmothers are kind of like shepherds, aren't they? They take care of us. And the other thing we're doing, at 11 o'clock, there's going to be a group of high school seniors down here that are just about to graduate from high school. They'll be leaving home and going to college or going to jobs in the fall. And what we know is that when they trust the shepherd, that God will lead them and guide them just like a shepherd, no matter where they are. And we trust that they know his voice and that they'll listen to his voice. I want you to do something with me. I want you to repeat. I'm going to say the first line of Psalm 23, and then I want you to say it after me. Okay? The Lord is my shepherd, I have everything I need. The Lord is my shepherd, I have everything I need. That's right. Let's pray. Thank you, God, that you are our good shepherd. Lord, help us listen to your voice. Help us trust you. We know, God, that you are with us all the time and that you truly give us everything we need. In Jesus, the good shepherd's name, I pray. Amen. Bye, y'all.
Our offertory hymn is number 601, Thy Word is a Lamp. Each time the refrain occurs, it comes right at the beginning. Each time it occurs, we'll sing through twice. Would you please stand, number 601. Most gracious God, we thank you for the light you shine in our lives. We thank you for every gift you bless us with. Be with us as we bring these offerings. Let them be a gift to your kingdom. We bring them in the name of the Christ. Amen. You may be seated.
Though I appreciate the clarity of the modern translations, I consider the Psalms in the King James Version the high point of the English language. So I'm going to read from the King James. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Thank y'all very much. This is a week of transitions and celebrations. You may notice that at the 11 o'clock service, not only are we going to honor our high school graduates, but we will have a baptism, welcoming a new infant into this family, this church family. exams are over and colleges are having graduation starting this weekend. I just spent the last week with my family, my girls and my sons-in-laws, that we were celebrating the post-baccalaureate graduations of our daughters and our sons-in-law, although one daughter has not finished that pesky dissertation. We did allow her to come to Disney World with us anyway. You may have seen the Facebook post or the tweet of us wearing our maroon Egg Bowl shirts on Maroon Friday at the Magic Kingdom. We have this wonderful picture that went on Facebook of us right in front of Cinderella's castle with our Egg Bowl maroon t-shirts. But you'd be shocked to realize how many people in this world do not know what the Egg Bowl means. Or that it is the most important football game of the season. But we were glad to explain it to them. And fortunately, we didn't get into any fights or anything like that. We're glad to be there, glad to be back, but it was fun to spend that time with our family because we had not spent that much time together in about 4 years and probably won't spend that much time together again for another 4 years when they all get out of residency and such. And of course, it is Mother's Day. It's the last home baseball game of the regular season. We'll keep hoping on other things. So there is a lot to celebrate this weekend. But let me start with Mother's Day as I try to tie all these transitions and all these celebrations together. As wonderful day as Mother's Day is in the church, it's kind of a hard day to preach. And it's not that the Bible doesn't celebrate motherhood. The Bible, of course, commands us to honor our fathers and mothers. But the truth is that most of the Bible stories having to do with motherhood celebrate hard work and sacrifice much more than flowers and cards and breakfast and bed. But what makes it really hard to preach on Mother's Day is simply the reality of life. I'm always careful with this holiday because I know that not everyone has the same experience with their mothers. Most of us have had wonderful experiences and wonderful memories. But many of us, even when the end result's been wonderful, our relationship with our mother went through, let's say, phases. That's a good way of putting it. When we were little, everything was flowers and love, and mama was so smart, and mama was so wonderful, and mama was just everything. Daddy was around, but mama was mama, and that's the way it is. But then somewhere between 10 and 14, depending on when adolescence kicks in, those of y'all with fifth graders, just watch out. She becomes this person who says no all the time. No, you can't go there. No, you can't go out with him. No, you can't do that. No, dear Lord, no, you are not, you are not, you are not leaving the house looking like that. And at that point, your relationship becomes maybe a little bit strained. But there comes another stage, and usually it hits around 18, maybe not till 20, maybe not till 22, but somewhere in there when all of a sudden she becomes wise and agreeable and loving and lovable again. And definitely by the time you start bringing home grandchildren, she even makes another change because not only does she become this loving person you remember, she becomes even more loving and even more generous and even more forgiving and definitely more permissive with her grandchildren than she ever was with you or even your siblings that you know she liked best. Those phases can be confusing. Sigmund Freud has kept 3 generations of psychotherapists in business by getting us through those phases with our mothers. I joke, but just a little. But we know that there are others whose experience with their mothers and their experience maybe with motherhood has taken different paths. And in those cases, we do thank God for the grandparents and the fathers who acted like mother and father, and the aunts and the big sisters and the adoptive parents and the stepmothers and the foster mothers and all those who have been like a mother to us. As well, we thank God for the opportunities to love and teach and share with all these children that are around us. Because for no person, it's never just your own child. It is this community. It is this church family. As I said, when we baptize this baby at the 11 o'clock, we will all pledge to make this child part of our lives. We will all pledge to be mothers and fathers and family to this little baby that's coming before us today. And that's one of the great things about being in a church. No matter if your children have gotten off and run off someplace else and gotten old and grown up, there are always children who need our shared love and our shared care. So today we honor our mothers, and we honor all those who have loved us like a mother. One thing that I've noticed over the years that's appropriate for both the Baccalaureate Sunday and Mother's Day, it's a lesson that some have learned from great mothers, and I know some people who've learned this very same lesson from not so great mothers. And the lesson is, you are responsible for your own life. That's one thing I'm going to tell these new graduates today, and I tell everyone I know about it, because I think it's one of the most important lessons to hear. Some of our best mothers have taught us that through patience and through that wonderful combination of freedom and accountability. And I know some other people who learn that lesson in more difficult ways, but it is true. In the end, we will have and we will make choices, and we will be responsible for the outcomes of those choices, and that is our life. Yes, a lot of things can affect our lives, but ultimately, the choices we make have a lot to do with how our stories turn out. Yes, there are outside factors. The genetics we inherit and our natural abilities play a role. But we have all seen people who got the absolute most out of very limited talent, natural talent. And we have all seen people who had all the natural talent in the world and who wasted it with bad decisions and poor uses of those talents. I won't name any names, but every MSU sports fan just had a couple of images run through their... Actually, they had a couple of images walk slowly down the court through their mind, but it's the same with time and circumstances. Yes, some people have advantages, and some people have disadvantages, and I'm not saying they're not real, but we all know people who had nearly everything and lost it, and we all know people who started with nearly nothing and found a way to build something out of that. And we know that how people treat us does affect us, especially when we're young. It affects our outlook on life. But through my years of ministry, I have known people who chose to see early pain and early hardship in their life as reason to see themselves as victims. And I know people who have gone through horrible things, terrible things in their early life, but they see it now as reason to consider themselves victors, as reasons to see themselves as people who have triumphed. Even those things, they affect our lives, but still, what we do with it does matter. The parable of the talents reminds us that not everyone is dealt the same hand, but we are all held accountable for how we play the hand we are dealt. It matters what we do with what we have. It matters what we do with the opportunities or the challenges or the problems or the possibilities that are put before us. You know, I'm not going to tell these graduates who come before us today that anything is possible. I'm pretty sure genetics and practice mean that none of them are going to make it to the NBA. But if you read their profile here, I think we could put together a pretty good jazz combo out of the group. There is a lot of talent there. But I will tell them that there are more possibilities than they can imagine. There will be options, there will be possibilities, there will be challenges, there will be decisions. And I will tell them that the choices they make are so vitally important as they pick through all those opportunities, all those things that present, all those temptations that present themselves throughout life. It is their life. It is your life. It's not just for 18-year-old high school graduates. For all of us, it is your life. And no matter where we are in life, there are still many choices to be made. That got me thinking about the Serenity Prayer. It's one thing I was going to offer to our high school graduates. I like it because in one sense, it talks about dealing with the realities that confront us. But in another sense, it reminds us that there are things that can be changed. There are things that should be confronted. There are things that we can do something about. And the true wisdom in life is figuring out, when are we butting our head up against a rock that cannot be moved? Or when do we have the opportunity to make a decision that makes a difference? You've heard part of the Serenity Prayer before, but you may not have heard the whole thing. God, grant me the grace to accept with serenity the things that cannot be changed, courage to change the things which should be changed, and the wisdom to distinguish the one from the other. Living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as a pathway to peace, taking, as Jesus did, the sinful world as it is and not as I would have it, and trusting that you will make all things right if I surrender to your will, so that I may be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with you forever in the next. Amen. I'm going to share Dr. Niebuhr's wonderful prayer with our graduates, but the other gift that I'm going to share with them are these words. We've read them one time, but it never hurt to read them again. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. We are responsible for our own lives, but we are not alone in these lives. We have mothers, fathers, family. We have friends, teachers, colleagues, scout leaders, coaches, buddies. We have a church family. We have also someone who knows us and loves us and loves us anyway and watches over us and guides us and forgives us like a mom, like a good shepherd. To make it through, we need families. We need friends. We need churches. We need moms. But to make it sure, we also need to know that we have this good shepherd who watches over this tiny little baby that we're going to bring before us today, who watches over these graduates as they go off to college and new adventures, who gives patience and strength to all the mothers of our lives, and who is with us all the days of our lives. That's the good news as we go out into the world this Mother's Day, this graduation season. That our lives are ours. They are our responsibility. But we do not go out alone. Let us pray. Most good and gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you for all those who have loved us. And we thank you that your love pours down upon us. Be with us as we go out into life. Be with us as we go out to be the people that you know we can be. We go in the name of the Christ. Amen.
Our hymn is number 128, He Leadeth Me, O Blessed Thought. Would you please stand as we sing all four verses?
Thank you.
May the power of the Holy Spirit be with you as you go. Amen.